Morning, good morning. I'm glad when they said, let's go to the house of the Lord. Hey, something tonight that we're going to, this kind of a spur of the moment. I've had a couple of people say, hey, I've been reading in the book of Acts. I've been reading Corinthians, and I don't understand this. It talks about these folks praying in some strange language, tongues, some kind of tongues. Said, I don't understand. Say, you know, kind of way, it's kind of weird. It's kind of out there on it. And so anyway, tonight at 6 o'clock, I'm going to be here. And if you would like to understand, what is it talking about? Praying in tongues. What does that mean? Is that still for today? Is that passed away? So, like, you know, it's in the Bible, but do we still do it today? On it, does it still happen today? On it. So anyway, I'll be here at 6 o'clock. Won't be any hype or no music, no nothing. I'll just, matter of fact, when I'm teaching on it or whatever, you can interrupt me. Say, hey, you lost me there. I don't know what you're talking about. What's that talking about? What does that mean? What is that on it? So anyway, I'll be up here at 6 o'clock. If you're one of those that's been reading that and thinking about it, on it, be no pressure on you. Just share what the Bible says concerning it. Amen, amen. Bow your head, turn your Bible to 1 Timothy 6:12. Father, we bless you, we praise you, we thank you, Lord. You're a mighty God. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. Open our hearts and ears to receive from you. And Lord, we give you glory and honor in Jesus' mighty name. Everybody said amen. This is the second sermon on a collision with God. And when you have a collision with God, the purpose of it is to give you a revelation. And the revelation has to be interpreted. And then the interpretation is applied to your life. The principle of that begins to take place. And last Sunday, I gave a little example of a little teenage gal, or I guess she's a little older than that, in our church that had a revelation, and she interpreted and she applied it to her lives. And we gave a couple examples from the Bible of people having revelations. A gal that, and the woman at the well, she had a revelation that Jesus was a prophet. Jesus said, hey, you got five husbands. The one you're living with is not your husband. And she revealed, she said, I perceive you're a prophet. You know what? She was right. She got a revelation. That collision with God produced a revelation. And she had another revelation. Another revelation is, you know all things. And out of that revelation, she went and told others about it. And she was still working on whether he's the Son of God, whether he's the Messiah. Because she said something, can he be the Messiah? And Jesus told her, yeah, I am. I am the one. But she was struggling. She was kind of struggling with that. And we don't know how it turned out completely. But we know they had the revivals. Jesus stayed there 2 days and they began to believe. So you would assume that she got through that struggle and said, yeah, he is the Son of God. Yeah, yeah, that's who he is. And hopefully she went and told her live-in, said, I'm sorry, but I don't have sex out of marriage anymore. I'm sorry, the Son of the living God, I know him, and do it. And so what I really want to hit on here is the fight you have to realize you're having a collision with God. The fight you have, if you get through that, the fight you have to interpret it, and the fight you have for the application, applying it to your life. So I'm going to give a little experience here in my own life. In 1972, I got saved, filled with the power of the Holy Ghost in my home. Never read the Bible, didn't know anything about the Bible. And that night, I had a hard time sleeping, and I would get up and pray and get up and go away. And I never have a hard time sleeping. You say sleep, let's go on it. But I'm thankful that I don't, some people fight to sleep on it. I can sleep. And so I got up the next morning, my lovely wife was there, and I said, God's called me to preach. I said, I believe God's called me to preach. She says, what? You just got saved. And God's called you to preach? I said, yeah, I think God's called me to preach. And she said, we need to go talk to somebody. We need some counseling around here, you know. And so we went to a retired Assembly of God preacher that she knew and told him the experience. And basically he said, son, you don't know your head from a hole in the ground. He didn't say that, but he made it, you don't know anything. He said, you don't need to worry about that. He said, you need to get in a church, do everything that church is doing, take advantage of everything, every course they have, every Sunday school. You be at every prayer meeting, you be at work days. Basically what he was saying, if the pastor says jump, you say how high. You just submit to authority and get in there. And the Bible says your gift will make room for you. So he said, if you're called, if that's really, you really heard from God, then that gift will be manifested and it would come out of you. And I said, oh, that's a pretty good, I like that idea. So anyway, I just did exactly what he said. I got in church and involved in everything that was taking place, different other ministries and stuff. We, children's church pastors, or not pastors, but leaders of our local church. And we were working in two separate ministries. Frieda was working in a ladies, and I was in the men's, and so forth. So anyway, a few years passed by, and I'd kind of forgot about it. You know, it's just an emotional thing. I just got saved, and I was real emotional after getting saved. And so anyway, we went to a prayer meeting every Friday night, and a guy came in to preach. He's an evangelist with a strong prophetic anointing upon him. And he prophesied over him and said, you've been called to preach. And Frieda said, what do you think about that? I'm not good at standing up and preaching before people. No, that's not. So probably a month, 5 months later or so, another guy came in. He prophesied over me. And he said, you've been called to preach. And by then I had me a good job. I had three screaming kids. Life was good. My house was paid for. On it. And so I was ready to just float through life, be a nice little Christian, go to church, tithe, help, be in the helps ministry, kind of behind the scene guy there and praying with people and so forth and along. So I was just kind of floating through life, and he prophesied. So now I had a collision when I got up after I got saved. Then I had two people prophesy. I have a collision. I've had three collisions, but I ain't got it. I still ain't got the revelation. What's the revelation? I've been called to preach. And so anyway, this guy, I'd go to a men's breakfast. And in that men's breakfast every Saturday, I'd go to it, and the guy over it, he would try to get you to stand up and give a little testimony or do a little devotional or something. And everybody was just getting up, 10 minutes, 15 minutes at the most type deal. And so he wanted me to do it, and I said, nah, I'm not good at that kind of stuff. I'm kind of a behind-the-scenes type guy. And so he'd drop in at my job where I was working. And he said, look, we really need you to do it. And so finally I said, okay, I'll do it. So I got me a few scriptures and on J.R.'s his daughter getting raised from the dead. And I was going to give a few scriptures and say a few things on it, and knock this baby out and get it over with. And so I got up there, and when I started, the anointing of God came upon me, and all of a sudden I started preaching. And this word, the anointing, John Bevere, Wednesday night on his, he had a similar experience that he was telling us about. And so I probably went 30 minutes or so, normally go 10, 15 on it, and I could have kept going. And kind of when I'm doing it, I'm kind of thinking, this ain't me. This isn't me. This is strange. This isn't me. And so anyway, afterwards this guy came up and said, man, I didn't know you were called to preach. And that guy came to my job and said, we got to have you again because you got the anointing and call to preach on your life. And all of a sudden it hit me. I got the revelation. Duh. After three collisions, finally the fourth collision, Then finally, I got what God's saying. You've been called to preach. Well, what happened when you say called to preach? You know what I said? I got problems now. I got real problems because my life is fixing to strain. It's fixing to be totally headed in a different direction that I ever planned on, ever dreamed on, never asked for, never wanted, and now all of a sudden it's going to be done. So what I have to do next? Come on, help me. Interpret. Help. I got to interpret this. What does this mean? I'm going to preach. And you know, the way I didn't understand revelation, interpretation. I didn't understand. I said, well, what do I need to do now? Now that I'm called to preach, what do I need to do? What I need to do, I was already reading the Bible, praying and prayer meeting, but said, I got to put it up a notch. I got to get in that word. I got to meditate that word. I got to speak the word. I got to get my prayer life rolling. I got to spend at least an hour a day praying in the Holy Ghost and worshiping God, seeking God, because I got a call upon my life. I'm going to do it. And you know what happened? After I started doing that, and sure enough, the door opened, people, and a church was open, and I became the pastor. And so I had the revelation, the interpretation, the application. But my point I'm trying to get across to you is there's going to be a fight. Once you have that collision, you're going to have to fight to realize it's a collision from God. You're going to have to fight to get the interpretation. You're going to have to fight to do the application and apply it to your life. Now, here's what I want you to see. Here I got saved and filled with the power of the Holy Ghost, called to preach, going into the ministry. That's probably 75, maybe 76 on it. And now we're in 2019. Let me tell you, you think on the way from starting to preach all the way to 2019, you think I might have had some disappointments. You think I might have had some discouragement. You think I might have had some betrayal. You think I might have had some pity parties, feeling sorry for myself, how hard I got it. You know, if I wasn't preaching, things wouldn't be this hard. You think I had any questions along the line? You know, is this really God's will? Is this really, you know, if God's will, it'd be done. Anyway, what I'm trying to say, there's a fight that took place between that time and 2019. But here, that collision with God, I'm still living off of that collision with God today. But you know what? Every time I'd get discouraged, obstacles, these things take place, you know what I'd say? I'd say, let me tell you, I got a revelation. I'm called to preach. I got the anointing of God. The word of God's on me. I'm not quitting. I'm not giving up. There was never a question whether I was called to preach. There was some question, you know, what position in the five, apostle, prophet, teacher, evangelist, pastor, so forth, on it. There was a question there, but never a question. That's how powerful a collision of God will be in your life. And we're going to give an example here in a little bit of a man who had a collision with God. And buddy, when he did, he had a fight on his hands to hold fast and do the will of God in his life. He wants you to get this collision of God just to be kind of a vague memory, something in the past that happened and you were just emotional at that time. He's going to try and talk you out of it. You found 1 Timothy 6:12. The Apostle Paul, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Paul says you're going to have to fight the fight of faith. You're going to have to do it. Well, the fight of faith, well, what is he fighting for with his faith? What is the fight that he's talking about here? Now, later on, 2 Timothy, he says, I have fought a good fight. In other words, he's saying, I've won. I have fought the good fight. I have finished my course. And now, there's a crown of righteousness waiting for me, man. He's ready for it. What's he doing? So when he talks about here, he's giving you two powerful things to help you fight the fight of faith. Now here's what Paul had to fight. You remember he was blinded on the way to Damascus. God told him, go to a street called Straight, and there's a guy named Ananias, and he's going to minister to you. And so he does. Ananias lays hands on him, and his eyes are open, and now he sees. And then Ananias begins to prophesy over Paul. And in that prophetic word that Ananias is giving Paul, he tells him very plainly, you have been called to preach to the Gentiles. That's your number one ministry? That's where you're going? What is that? That's a collision. That's a revelation that the Apostle Paul has. That's a word that he's gotten from God. He is called to the apostle. What's a Gentile? Anybody that's not a Jew, guess what? Paul is my personal apostle who has been called to me. And he has written me 13 books. I'd be a fool not to read those 13 books from my apostle. He's not apostle to the Jews. He's apostle to me and the Gentiles. Glory to God. What a blessing. What an honor on it. Man. That makes me want to go home right now and start reading the epistles again, read those 13 books again, because it's there for me, amen? And so now, what happened when you read the book of Acts with Paul? He has this vision, he has this revelation, and you get down to here, what is it? It's a fight. Is that right? He got beat? He got stoned? Come on now. He got stripes put on him? He had all of that thing. Why? They're fighting him to keep, the devil's fighting him to get him where he misinterprets it and he never applies it. But thank God he's applied it. That's why I'm here today, because of what the Apostle Paul did. Whew, glory to God. Isn't that incredible? So now he's telling us how to fight. So obviously this is the way he fights. And he said the number one thing you're going to have to do is lay hold on eternal life. Well, what does that mean? Sounds like he did it. How did he do it? Over in Timothy, he said, this is the way I did it. I got to thinking about my crown of righteousness that I'm going to have. It's eternity. I've got that right. I'm going to get that crown. It's going to be on my head. He's looking more to eternity than he is now, and that's giving him the fight to live off of that collision he had with God all the way to the finish. That's how powerful the collision of God is on it. And so he gets that revelation. Look not at the things that are seen, but the things that are not seen. For the things that are seen are temporal, things not are seen are eternal. So he's looking at something eternal that he cannot see. What is it? It's a crown of righteousness. Amen. And then he says, you're going to have a good confession. You got to get your mouth straight. You know, what is a good confession? Well, let's give some examples. What is a bad confession? The Apostle Paul gets a prophetic word for Ananias, says, you know, I'm going to the Gentiles. And God's calling me to the Gentiles. And he says, there's no way I could ever do that. You know, I'm just one person. I can't preach. I can't do that. What is that? Somebody say a bad confession. Well, what's a good confession, Apostle Paul? A good confession? Yeah, I can. God called me to the Gentiles. You know what? I can bring Gentiles into the kingdom of God. I've got the call on my life. I've got the anointing upon my life. I can do this with the help of God Almighty. Is that a good confession? That's a good confession. Well, I'm called to preach. What's a bad confession? Well, I'm just unworthy and I'm just no good. And I could never do that. I could never stand upon people and preach. And da, 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 da. What is that? Somebody say a bad confession. That's not a good confession. That's a bad thing. So what did I have to do to get to where I am now? Number one, I got to keep looking at eternity. Number two, I got to keep saying, well, what if you preach a bad sermon? I'm still called to preach. I still got the call upon me. I still got the anointing, the Apostle Paul. What if he makes some mistakes? He still got the call. He still got the anointing upon him. It's all there, still there. Amen? Are you getting it? In John the 9th chapter, Big John, Gospel of John, John the 9th chapter, amazing story. It says, as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from his birth, and his disciples asked him, saying, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? He was born blind. And they're asking the question, did his parents sin or did he sin? Now, you'd think you'd look at that. Now, I could see the parents. But how could this guy, when's he going to sin before he was blind? Then he'd had to sin in his mother's womb because he was born blind. So he's already blind before he ever had a sin. So you think you could call him on it? So, and Jesus tells him, says, it's not either one of them. You know what one of our problems is a lot of times when you're in a mess? You're trying to figure out why you're in this mess rather than trying to figure out how you get out of the mess. This guy's blind from birth. He's got a mess. Disciples are trying to figure out why. Jesus is trying to figure out how we get him out of this mess. How do we get him healed? What do we have to do? And Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but the works of God should be revealed to him. I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no man works. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And when he had said these things, he spit on the ground, and he made clay, anointed his eyes of the blind man with the clay, and he said unto him, go wash at the pool called Siloam, which is translated sin. So he went, washed, and came back seeing. So here he is, puts the mud, makes some mud and clay, whatever, puts on his eyes, he washed, comes back healed. Anybody think he may have had a collision with God? What does it mean when you have a collision with God? You're going to have to interpret it. What else are you going to do? You're going to have to apply it to your life. This guy's had a collision with God. You know what else that means? There's going to be a fight. You got to fight. There's a fight to bring this thing to where God wants it to be done. And so now, here he comes. Therefore, the neighbors and those who previously had seen him that he was blind said, is not this he who said and begged? Some said, this is he. Others said, he is like him. He said, I'm he. I'm the one. I'm the one that's been begging all this time. I ain't changed a bit except I can see now. Therefore they said unto him, how were your eyes open? He answered and said, a man called Jesus made clay, anointed my eyes, and said to me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash. So I went and washed, and I received my sight. Then they said to him, where is he? Where is he? He said, I do not know. He said, I don't know. I don't know who this guy. Now notice the revelation he's got at this time. He's got a revelation, and this is the revelation. I was blind, but now I see. And this man, that's what he says, this man, and he's got a name, and his name is Jesus. And so he's responsible for me seeing. So he really doesn't have a revelation as to who Jesus is. All he knows at this time is that he's a man. And they brought him who formerly was blind to the Pharisees. Now it was the Sabbath when Jesus made the clay and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also asked him again how he had received his sight. He said to them, he put clay on my eyes and I washed and I see. Therefore, some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God because he does not keep the Sabbath. Well, he's healed, but he doesn't keep the Sabbath. Jesus heals on the Sabbath, so he doesn't keep, he's not keep, so yeah, he can't be of God. This is great, you know. Couldn't be of God. Others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such signs? And there was a division among them. They said to the blind man again, what do you say about him because he opened your eyes? He said, he's a prophet. Woo. That's what the woman at the well said. I perceive you're a prophet. So now he's got a revelation. What's his revelation? This collision with God has brought him from Jesus being a man, which Jesus is a man. So he was right on that revelation. The next one is, Jesus is a prophet. Well, he's right on that. So he's getting tremendous revelations from God. the Jews, the Pharisees, they hadn't got this revelation. They don't even believe he's of God. But the Jews did not believe. The Jews did not believe. They, of their own free will, decided they did not believe concerning him. That he'd been blind, received his sight, until they called the parents of him who had received his sight. And they asked them, saying, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he see?" Okay. His parents had an answer to him. "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but by what means he now sees, we do not know. Or who opened his eyes, we do not know." Liar, liar, pants on fire. "He is of age. Ask him. He will speak for himself." And his parents said these things because they feared. Somebody say feared. "The Jews, for the Jews have agreed that if anyone confessed that he was Christ, he would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, he is of age. Ask him." His parents need to become politicians. They would make good politicians. They don't want to be one way. They don't want to be another way. I mean, if I'm the guy that got healed, I would kind of get a feeling that my parents have betrayed me. You know, why don't my parents stand up and say, "Yeah, that's my son. Yeah, and he says it's Jesus, who he believes is a prophet, healed him. And you know what? I'm giving glory to this guy. I don't know anything about him, don't understand everything about him. I don't know, but all I know, my son was blind, now he sees, and we're praising God and we're thankful for him, and I'd like to know him and I'd like to learn more about him." Now, wouldn't that be a nice way to do it? Wouldn't that be the way? And so they again called the man who was blind and said to him, give God the glory. We know that this man is a sinner. He answered and said, "Whether he is a sinner or not, I do not know. One thing I know, that though I was blind, now I see." Now, he says, later on, he retracts this statement. He says, "Whether he's a sinner or not, I do not no. Well, later on, he's going to change that. Hang on. "Then they said to him, what did he do to you, and how did he open the eyes?" He answered, "I've told you already, and you did not listen." They listened, but they didn't want to hear. "Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to be his disciples?" Then they reviled him and said, "You are his disciples, but we are Moses' disciples. We know that God spoke to Moses, as for this fellow, we do not know where he's from." The man answered and said, "Why, this is a marvelous thing that you do not know where he's from. Yet he has opened my eyes. Now we know that God does not hear sinners." Now, earlier he said what? "Whether he's a sinner or not, I don't know. I just know he opened my..." But now he got to thinking about it and said, "Wait a minute. This guy's not a sinner. Sinners don't go around opening eyes. They don't do that. So God does not hear sinners. God heard him, so therefore Jesus is not a sinner." He's getting another revelation. Where did this revelation come from? His collision with God. No collision, no revelation. But he got a collision with God, and now he's got a powerful, powerful revelation that Jesus, he's not a sinner, but he says this, "But if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, he hears him." So now he's got a revelation that Jesus is a man, Jesus is a prophet, and Jesus, and before that, it says he was sent from God. He believes he's sent from God. Now he's got a revelation that this guy, Jesus, is not a sinner. He's got this powerful revelation that, let me tell you something, God, he's got to be from God, because he's not a sinner, he's a worshiper of God, and he does the will of God. All of that revelation coming out of that collision with God. And then, if this man were not of God, he could do nothing. 34th verse. They answered and said to him, "You were completely born in sin. You are teaching us," and they cast him out. Jesus heard that he had been cast out, and when he had found him, he said to him, "Do you believe in the Son of God?" He answered and said, "Who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him?" Jesus said to him, "You have both seen him, and it is he who is talking with you." He said the same thing to the woman at the well, that I am he. I am the Son of God. And she took that he could be, can it be? But he took it and he said, "Lord, I believe." Jesus said to him, "You have both seen him, and it is he who he is talking with." And he said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Jesus said, "For judgment I have come into the world, that those who do not see may see, and those that who see may be made blind." And some of the Pharisees who were with him heard these words and said to him, "Are we blind also?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would have no sin. But now you say, 'We sin,' therefore your sins remain." Now notice what happened now. He's got this revelation. And the revelation is, he's a man, he's a prophet, he's sent from God. This man is not a sinner. He's a worshiper of God. On it, he does the will of God. Then he's got another powerful. This man is the Son of God. He's the Messiah. He got the revelation. Well, how does he interpret it? What is the interpretation now? One interpretation that I think he already have is, I'm going to make a stand for this guy. I don't care what the religious freaks are saying. I don't care what mama's saying. I don't care what daddy's saying. They won't stand with me, but let me tell you something. I'm going to stand with this guy. I believe in him. Abraham Lincoln, if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. That's why so many Christians fall into sin. You know why they fall into sin? Because they won't stand. They won't make a stand for the Word of God and the Word of truth. And if they don't make a stand for it, then they'll fall into something else. Now, hallelujah. Now notice, how does he apply this? What is the application of this powerful revelation and interpretation that he has? You know how he does it? He worships Jesus. Is that what he said? He worshiped Jesus. So he went from this blind guy having a collision with God to worship Jesus. Well, three things. He's got a revelation, and he's done one out of the three. What's the first revelation? The three revelations. Number one, he says, don't sin. Number two, worship God. Number three, do the will of God. Is that what he said? That's what he said. That's why he knew Jesus. Jesus was of God. He wasn't a sinner, because he had that revelation. So we know he worshiped God. What's his next two applications? Don't be a sinner. And say, don't sin, but don't be a sinner. There's a difference between sinning and being a sinner. You may sin, but you're not a sinner. Well, I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. Liar, liar. You were an old sinner. You were saved by grace. But now you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That's who you are. You're not a sinner. You don't understand, Pastor. I went out and got sloppy drunk last night. You sinned. But you're not going to do it no more, so you're not a sinner. Now, if you do it every day, once a week, then now you're developing into a thinner. But if you thin, that'll make you thinner. You might be able to play basketball, but you're not a basketball player. You might be able to change the shocks on your vehicle, but you're not a mechanic. There's a difference between changing the shocks on your car and being a mechanic. There's a difference between sinning and being a sinner. The guy, you remember last time, the guy was crippled for 38 years, and Jesus said, take up your bed and walk. And what did he do? How did he interpret this? He became a sinner. And Jesus said, if you keep sinning, you keep being a sinner, something worse will come up on you. On it. So he got through. Now let me tell you, four things this man had to fight, four things I had to fight. I looked at this and I said, my God, I went through all of that myself. And four things you're going to have to fight. Four voices are going to come to you when you get this collision from God. Voice number one, the voice of familiarity. You know what? When I finally got the revelation, I am called to preach. You know what friends said? You got a wife and three kids. You can't just preach. You know, you got a job. You got things to do. You can't just do that. Yeah, you got responsibilities. You got things. What happened to this guy? His neighbors and friends said, I don't know if that's him or not. I wonder if that's him. What's that him? That couldn't be him. He couldn't be healed. He couldn't be like that. There's no way that could happen. That's what they said. That's what they said when I said, I won't preach. They did the same thing. What is it? I got to fight it. I don't care what they said. I got a revelation from God. I don't care what they say. I know God healed me. I know I could see, but now I couldn't see, but now my eyes are open. What's the second voice? He had to fight religion. Religion came to him and said, look, here, this guy is not of God because he healed on the Sabbath. He's not. We are disciples of Moses, not him. So he couldn't do it. He couldn't be of God. So he had this voice of religion coming to him. And if he would have listened to the voice of religion, he would have never have gone any further of believing that he is Lord, and he never would have worshipped him. You say, what is religion? What is religion? What do you mean by religion? Religion is when you won't change. That's all you have to do. Isn't this not change? This is the way I am. This is the way I am. You know what Jesus said? Jesus come to make your life better. I've come to give you life and give it to you more abundantly. What does that mean? That means you can have a better marriage. You can have better children. What does that mean? You can have better finances. What do I mean? You can have more favor with God than you've ever had. You can have it better. Everything's better. Jesus come to give it to you better. Religion tells you, no, it can't get any better. You can't get any better. Your kids can't get any better. Your marriage can't get any better. Your finances can't get any better. It can't ever get any better. That's what religion tells you. You can't get any better. You can't see. You can't not be a sinner. You can't worship him. You can't do that. That's the way religion always talks and always speaks. Now, you would think, they said, well, we don't believe in healing on the Sabbath, but this guy got healed on the Sabbath, so therefore our doctrine is wrong, so we're going to change our doctrine, and now you can get people healed on the Sabbath. And they'd change their doctrine. But they never even entered their mind, change their doctrine. Our doctrine's right. So his doctrine's got to be wrong. Don't everybody shout me down now. And you know what? The third one, the voice of unbelief. You know what the Pharisees said? They looked at him and he said, I will not believe. I am not. You see, faith, doubt, is a choice. It starts with a choice. You can decide whether you want to believe, or you can decide if you don't want to believe. That is your responsibility. That is where you can call. Amen. You can make that decision. Remember what Thomas said? He missed Jesus. He skipped church one time, and Jesus walked through the walls. That's why I don't miss church. I want to be at church because Jesus might come walking through the walls, and I'm at home in my lazy boy. And I missed it. Well, that's what happened to Thomas. And then you know what happened? They told him Jesus walked through the walls, came to church, and he said, what? I'm not going to believe. He said, I will not believe. What was that? A choice, a decision that he made, I will not believe. You know what that guy with blind heel? He decided, I'm going to believe. I am a believing dude, man. Just tell me what I need to believe and with Jesus, and I'm going to believe it. And the last one was what? The fear, the voice of fear. Why did his parents throw him under the bus? You know why they threw him under the bus? Fear. They said they feared that they would be kicked out of the synagogue. And so therefore, they let that fear make their decision what they were going to say and what they were going to do, and the fear controlled them and talked to you. You know, let me tell you something. All four of these, I had religion talk to me. I had friends. I had my parents. They said, well, you know, if you're going to preach, after they tried to talk to me, I said, if you're going to preach, then we'll help send you to Perkins Theological School in Dallas, and you can go through the theological seminary. I said, I got enough problem with unbelief without them teaching me that everything's passed away and nothing ever works anymore. Man, I'm already fighting doubt and fear and unbelief on it, and then I'm going to go to a school that they're going to teach me that fear and all that is right, and that's all truth. So now you just go through life living in fear and doubt the rest of your life. Somebody shout amen. Lift your hands to heaven. Father, we bless you. We praise you. We thank you, Lord. You're a mighty God. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. Lord, guide us, lead us. Father, we thank you, Lord. Father, for your word. Father, we desire to have a collision with God. We want a collision with you, Lord. Father, we want your presence. We want your anointing. We want your will in our lives. And Father, we're going to purpose like this man who was healed. We're not going to be sinners. We're going to worship you. And Lord, we're going to do the will of God in our lives, Father. And we thank you for that. And we believe it. We're going to apply those principles to our lives in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody shouted, amen. Right quick, just give me 5 minutes right quick. Let me ask you a big question, important question. Question is this. What do you have to do to go to heaven? How do you go to heaven? What do you do to go to heaven? I think last Sunday I was talking about a guy that talked to him last month. And I asked him, what do you have to do to go to heaven? He said, well, here's the deal. Everybody sins. Isn't that right? Everybody sins. Yeah, that's right. Right? We will. You are going to commit a sin. He says, so it's not big sins. It's not those little sins that matter anything. It's just big sins. So if you commit big sins, you won't go to heaven. But if you just commit little sins, you'll go to heaven. I said, big sins? What are you talking about? Like murder? Like robbing a bank, like raping somebody. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. As long as you don't do that. And I said, well, not in the Bible. Not in the Bible. Others say, most of them say, if you're a good person, try to do right, you'll probably go to heaven. Not in the Bible. Not in the Bible. You know, well, if you go to church, you know, God wants you to go to church. So if you go to church, you probably go to heaven. Not in the Bible. That's not in the Bible. Well, if I'm a morally sound person, not in the Bible. Well, how do you go to heaven? Well, Jesus made it very clear. Except a man be born again, he's not going to go to heaven. He'll not see heaven, experience heaven, enter into heaven. Will not enter into heaven. Huh. Well, what does that mean? What does being born again? Well, you have a spirit on the inside. You're born into sin. You just naturally sin. When you come into this world, you just don't sin. You are a sinner. And so what happens when you make Jesus the Lord of your life? If you will confess Jesus as your Lord, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. That word saved, it means the same thing as being born again. You'll have eternal life. Eternal life means the same thing as being born again, as being saved. And so you're born again. Well, what do you mean born again? Well, this spirit on the inside of you is recreated with the very nature of Almighty God. Now you're compatible to God. Now you can come boldly to the throne of grace and receive mercy and grace and help in time of need. You have access into the very presence of Almighty God. And the Bible says, with the heart man believes unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Incredible. So here's the deal. The deal is pretty simple. Somebody is going to pay for your sins. Either you're going to pay for your sins, or Jesus is going to pay for your sin. But somebody's going to pay for your sins. You see, Jesus came to this earth, no sin, went to the cross, died, buried, raised from the dead. And Jesus even did this. Incredible. He went into hell for 3 days and 3 nights. Jesus went into hell? Yeah, why did he do that? So you don't have to go. Now, you can go if you want to, but Jesus already went to hell and paid the price for you. And after 3 days, he arose from the dead. He came out of hell. He defeated the devil. He said, I am he that liveth that was dead. Behold, I am alive forevermore. I have the keys of death, hell, and the grave. What does that mean? I got the keys. You don't have to go there. You don't have to go. You see, here's the fact. Your sins have been forgiven. But here's the deal. Even the President of the United States of America, if he pardons a known convicted criminal, that guy does not go free until he signs a piece of paper accepting the pardon. Jesus has paid the price for your sins. Now what you got to do is sign the pardon. How do you do that? By making Jesus the Lord of your life. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to count to three, and I'm going to shout hallelujah. And if you're here and you say, Pastor, I want to make Jesus the Lord of my life, I want you just to raise your hand. Here's somebody says, well, you know, I've done that before, and I did something pretty bad. I said, I backslid. I went back living like the world, talking like the world, smoking what the world, watching the TV that they watch, and I backslid. You know what that means? That is horrible, horrible, horrible. But I got some news for you. Got some good news. The Bible says if you'll confess your sins, he's faithful and just forgive your sins, cleanse you from all unrighteousness. What does that mean? You can start over. You can start this thing all over. Even though you messed up, you were dumb, you were stupid, you did the wrong thing. But thank God now you can come and get a new start all over, like you never sinned before, like you never backslid before. Prodigal son backslid, and you know what? He came back to his father and they said, kill the fatted calf, not the skinny goat, the fatted calf. Said, you kill the best one. You put a ring on him. You bring him in. He's not going to be a servant. He's going to be a son with full authority and full power, and you can now come back and go boldly into the throne of grace. Whoa. So what are you saying, Pastor? I'm going to count to three. Shout hallelujah. You're here and you say, yeah, I backslid, but I'm going to get things right here this morning. I'm not waiting another day. I'm going to get it right here. You're here and you say, I haven't made Jesus the Lord of my life. I'm going to do it right now, right here. I'm not going to wait till later. I'm going to do it now. Somebody says, well, what if I raise my hand and somebody sees me and I get embarrassed? Well, you're in a safe place. You're in a place where people love you, care for you, respect you, honor you. However, even if it happened, I'd sure rather go to heaven embarrassed than go to hell not embarrassed. Hell's not a pretty place. It's uncontrollable weeping. Utter darkness. Gnashing of teeth. Incredible thirst. Just a little tip of water. I don't want to go to that place. Especially when Jesus has paid the price. So bow your head if you would. Nobody looking around. Going to count to three, shout hallelujah. You're here and you say, Pastor, I want to make Jesus the Lord of my life. This morning, I want to make Him my Lord, my Savior. I want to, you say, well, I backslid. I'm getting right with God. I did wrong. But let me tell you, I'm starting all over today right now. 1, 2, 3, hallelujah.